as a particle moves downstream, it can rotate, and this rotation is tied to the vorticity in the flow field. This is easiest to understand if we look at this fluid particle from a Lagrangian standpoint instead of an Eulerian. So let's look at our fluid particle here, and we'll give it a coordinate system here of x and y. So this particle is of width dx, of height dy, and this is at time t equals 0. Okay, and then we can look at some future time of that particle and look and see what it looks like at that point. So again, we'll have a coordinate system of x and y, and at some future time, this particle may have rotated. I'm going to try to draw a particle that has rotated, and so it has rotated. One side of it here has rotated by alpha, and we're going to say the other side here has rotated by beta. That's a little beta down there. So let's figure out, and this is at time equals t0 plus dt, some delta time into the future. So we can look at if we can look at the rotation of this particle in the limit as dt approaches zero, and that will tell us about the vorticity in this flow field. So in the limit as dt approaches zero, we want to look at the rotation of this fluid particle. So and this is best if we can look at if we treat these angles alpha and beta, and look at the equation S equals R theta, which you're all, I'm sure, familiar with, where S is this arc length, R is the radius, and theta is the rotation angle. So in the limit, as dt goes to zero, the arc length, for example, of this first one here would be the change in our x velocity over the change in y coordinate. So the partial of the x velocity with respect to the partial of y times dy. So this element has a height of dy, and then it rotated for a time of dt. So that would be the arc length there. And then if we say that the length here is dy, then theta, let's see, we can just rearrange this equation over here. Theta equals S over R. So so theta, or alpha, I should say, would be equal to, let me just clean that up real quick. Alpha would be equal to that arc length, which is the partial of the vx with respect to partial of y, times dy dt, divided by the length r, which in our case is dy. So that comes out to be the partial of vx over the partial of y times dt. We can do the same for beta, where now we're looking at the arc length is going to be the partial of vy over the partial of x times dx dt, and we're going to divide that by dx, which is the radius here, that the length of that side. And so that simplifies to the partial of vy over the partial of x times dt. Okay, so now let's look at an average rotation. And in We actually drew the rotation of alpha backwards. We gave it a negative sign. If Z is coming out of the board, then really that was a negative rotation that we drew there. So the average rotation would be equal to negative what we drew for alpha up there plus beta over 2, and then we'd also divide this by dt with respect to time. And so if we plug this in, we get, I'm going to put the beta component first, dvy dx, the dt's are going to cancel out, minus dvx dy divided by 2, and I'll just put a 1/2 out front. So that's the rotation of this fluid element. This is actually called the angular velocity. This is the angular velocity of that fluid element. This angular velocity is related to vorticity. In fact, vorticity is just equal to 2 times the angular velocity. So essentially, all we're going to do is get rid of that 1/2 there and call this the vorticity. Now, if we've written this in 2D, in 3D, the vorticity is defined as, we're going to use the symbol omega, and it's a vector. It is equal to del cross V. That's how we represent vorticity. So we can actually work this out in 3D. Omega is equal to del cross V, which we can write in the I, J, and K directions using the determinant here. So del cross V, so we're going to put del here in the second line, so it's going to be partial with respect to X, the partial with respect to Y, the partial with respect to Z, and then the three components of velocity are Vx, Vy, and Vz. So let's look at everything in the I direction. So everything in the I direction here is going to be d dy times vz minus d dz times vy. And then we can add what's in the J direction. In the J direction, we have d dz vx minus d dx vz. And then in the K direction, we have d dx vy minus d dy Vx. Okay, so this is an I, J, and K directions. This is these are the components that make up the vorticity, and we can just check our work here. In the K direction, that should be the same as in the two-dimensional direction here, where vorticity is twice that, and we can see that that is correct. Those two terms match. We've got the dvy dx minus dvx dy in both cases. But really, vorticity is a three-dimensional thing, and so this is how it's defined in three dimensions, and it's related to the angular velocity. It's simply twice the angular velocity. So if you know how to take the determinant in order to compute a cross product, which you should know how to do, then it's pretty simple to work out the components of vorticity in a three-dimensional flow field.